Hachette Audio presents Blood Father, written by Peter Craig, read by Kathe Mazur.
Investigation Report, number CS-1617-117, Supplement. Saturday, December 9th, 2000. Shortly after hearing a late local news report on the homicides in Topanga Canyon, Charlotte Villalobos of Canoga Park, California, called the West Valley Division to inform detectives of a potentially related event. On Saturday, December 9th, Mrs. Villalobos had been working the day shift as a cashier in a Walmart franchise located at 11334 Sherman Way Boulevard. At approximately 3:30 p.m., a teenage girl purchased a dozen packages of white box 9mm range ammunition, along with duct tape, rope, and bubble gum. Mrs. Villalobos states that the girl was shivering, scratching her neck repeatedly, and appeared to be high on narcotics. She was denied cigarettes when she refused to produce identification. When another shopper commented on her purchase, the girl replied that her boyfriend was teaching her to use a firearm. Approximately 5'10 to 6 feet, the girl wore a black t-shirt with a scarf, low-riding jeans, and flip-flop sandals. She is described as having light-colored blue eyes, like a husky, and long black hair. After paying in cash, the girl stopped beside a young child sitting in a mechanical flying saucer. She gave the boy her remaining change, then inserted a quarter, setting the device in motion. Subsequent to the call, shell casings recovered at the site on Old Topanga Road have been identified by forensics to be white box range ammunition. From ART, Calipatria, 41001. Lydia Jane, Part 1. Waiting at the curb with two loaded shopping bags as her ride approached down Sherman Way, Lydia imagined herself in the shotgun seat of each passing car. Disappearing was so easy. Open a door, plead to a stranger. She might drop down into a whole new life with some unsuspecting commuter, fall in love on her way out of trouble, lose herself in a whirlwind of gratitude, tell him stories at night, whisper about the miracle of their sudden meeting. Then she'd fold his laundry, have his babies, grow old in a weather-controlled rambler out in a bright and treeless subdivision. Anything was destiny if you worked it long enough. Maybe she'd just turn up dead in a drifter's suitcase, left in a bus station locker or a rest stop men's room. Every stranger was his own life and death riddle. Lydia, oh Lydia, she sang softly. Have you seen Lydia? She was drifting down deeper into that trance-like state, seeing messages on benches and storefront signs intended only for her. Injured at home or work? Another bench showed two blurry pictures of runaways, smiling despite their miserable eyes. The bus carried a placard for an upcoming premiere. He has the power to hear what women think. All of it, together, jumbled along with windshields flaring brief flashes of sunlight, patterns in the traffic, pedestrians in a suspicious swarm, moving as if choreographed, watching her. It was nearly coming together into a mystical language, a prophecy that she couldn't quite decipher. No, no, she whispered. Coincidence is just God's sense of humor. It was the sleep dep, she told herself. The sleep deprivation? Keep your eyes open long enough and you'll even see visions in a Walmart parking lot. She couldn't remember the last time she'd slept. The days behind her were as cluttered as this boulevard, spanning back through light and shade. She glanced away and read the smudging ink on her palms, an amnesiac's grocery list. 9mm, duct tape, twine, S-rounds, Winchester, die. And it seemed now a message from another lifetime. She understood. Spent as she was, she still knew that she was carrying the evidence. Out of all these magazines, at least a few rounds would pass through skin and bone and wind up in a coroner's office or an investigation file. And one of these bullets, down somewhere in the boxes and bags, was meant for her. "Lydia the Tattooed Lady," she sang, laughing suddenly at the thought. She was carrying the receipt for her own execution. The car pulled up. Three men were pressed together with jostling elbows into the small back seat, while in the front, her boyfriend, Jonah, patted his lap. She sat down onto his legs while he was midstream in an argument. "And when was the last time I broke a promise to either of you?" He tossed back a few boxes, and the car filled with the sound of loading magazines. By the shady window, the sweaty white kid complained that he was carsick and might throw up. Jonah told him to be professional. This group hadn't put in much work together, and Lydia worried that if he puked on someone, he might set off a gunfight at close range. Two of the men, Ivan Vasquez and Patricio Shoup Miramontes, had been jumped into a West Side clique long before they were shaving and now earned mercenary cash as bodyguards. Ivan was still as lithe and rubbery as a boy, with his shirt off and El Salvador tattooed in block letters across his hairless chest. He had a freckling of pink scars across his arms and collarbone where he'd once been sprayed with buckshot through a security door. Choup, his counterpart, drove the car, a short, broad-faced, broad-shouldered Chicano who rarely made a sound. He had Aztec symbols on his forearms, the Pachuco cross, and the word Canpol on the back of his fist, now gripping the wheel. Neither of these men had much love for the two valley dealers who tore open the boxes and parceled out magazines. One was Chase Sullivan, a disheveled kid with a goatee and oily hair in his face. In an oversized hockey jersey and shorts that hung to the bright snarl of tattoos on his calves, he seemed less like a gang member than the head of a gangster's fan club. The other was Cully, the car-sick dealer from Canoga Park, a short-breathed, heavy-set man who still managed to wear oversized pants. With his shaved head and eggshell complexion, he looked like a gargantuan baby. He whined that his gun didn't take these cheap-ass nines. "Cully, I thought you had a 9mm, said Jonah. "Nah, I said it 100 times already. It's a Ruger P89 and it's got an interchangeable barrel. But I lost the other one." Ivan sighed and shook his head. "So I need 30 Luger ammo." "You ain't gonna find Luger ammo at a motherfucking Walmart," said Chase. "Then I'm useless. I got 2 rounds. Shifting his weight beneath Lydia, Jonah dropped the mags from 2 gray handguns, then handed each back to Ivan to reload. Cully was still fretting that the ammo was garbage. Some of it looked scratched, and he argued with the others about whether or not brass could rust. When Jonah took back 1 loaded gun, he hugged his arms around Lydia and placed it into her hands, breathing beside her ear. She whispered, "I don't know what to do with that." With his lips against her neck, he said, "There's no safety. You just pull the slide. Gotta have your finger right on the trigger, square. Hit it. No more problems." His breath tickled her ear, and his lowered voice reminded her of that soft-spoken quality that had once been so surprising and attractive. When she'd first met him, his green eyes always fled away toward the floor. His smile was quick and bashful. He withheld so much energy in public until suddenly, in a private and heated moment, he could explode with a torrent of words, an urgent, intense speech. But what Lydia now recognized was the terrible stillness he showed when he was making plans. It amazed Lydia that in a car full of loud and rowdy thugs, Jonah should wind up seeming the most dangerous. He wasn't tough or streetwise like his bodyguards. He came from a rarefied, wealthy family, raised on both sides of the border, a mix of old money Mexican and new money Anglo. There was something about him like a lost and rumpled prince, wearing his nice clothes badly, a silk shirt untucked and sweat-stained. He paid for this support in the car, but they were loyal, Lydia knew, mostly because of this specific quality, the sense that he could, at any moment, do something far outside what anyone had considered. A ghoulish problem solver? He was meditating now. She could feel his heartbeat against her back. Cully said,
"We got a whole trunk full of rifles and shotguns, and she only gets this fucking range ammo? Your bitch fucked up, Jonah. I'm not even gonna fire up there."
"Hey," said Lydia, pushing her tongue through her gum and snapping it. "So, don't fire," Jonah said.
"Hey, excuse me," Lydia continued.
"Then I'm just gonna conserve my ammo, dog. It's like 50 cents a bullet anyway,"
Yvonne said.
50 cents a round? You better be in love."
"Excuse me," Lydia yelled over the chatter.
Cully glanced over at her, frowning. A loose bullet dropped onto the floor.
"Listen," said Lydia, pausing as she blew a small bubble and popped it. "You don't know me very well, so this is just like I'm telling you my boundaries, okay? Please don't call me a bitch."
Cully's mouth hung open. Yvonne and Chase hunched down and squirmed like pigs at a trough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.